Thank you very much, Ambassador Ong. It's a genuine honor to be affiliated with this great school as both a scholar and as a member of the RSIS Board of Governors. The transformation of RSIS over the past decade is one of the most impressive accomplishments in higher education in the 21st century, and I speak from a worldwide perspective. In a remarkably short period of time, RSIS has established itself as one of the best schools of international affairs in the world. And this is a great testament to the school's leadership, faculty, staff, and supporters. And I would say that RSIS's ascendance into the top ranks of international affairs schools also reflects very well on Singapore as a whole. RSIS is reinforcing Singapore's reputation for strategic thinking, world-class excellence, and international engagement. And because RSIS is a school of international affairs, these positive effects are global. And so I would like to congratulate everyone who has contributed to this tremendous and internationally important success. I'd also like to thank all of you for joining me here today to talk about U.S. foreign policy at this very interesting juncture in the U.S.'s political history. A few months ago, when I decided to give a lecture on this topic, I thought this would be a propitious time to take a look back at the track record of the Obama administration and to take a look ahead at the prospects for U.S. foreign policy in the next administration. And of course, I knew that the 2016 election would still be underway in April 2016, but I have to admit I didn't expect the campaign to be so volatile, to put it diplomatically. Winston Churchill famously observed that, and I quote, "Democracy is the worst form of government, except for all those other forms that have been tried from time to time," end quote. Elections bring out the best and worst in democracies, and this has been on full display in the United States during the current 2015-2016 electoral campaign. The good news in the States is that millions of new voters have become engaged in politics for the first time. The campaign of Bernie Sanders, for example, has brought many young people into politics. Senator Sanders has promised a political revolution, although, as far as I can tell, he hasn't explained how this will actually happen. As far as I can tell, magic will be involved. On the Republican side, the campaign of Donald Trump has also brought many new voters into the political process. Just last week, one of his campaign organizers said, and again I quote, "I've been involved in politics exactly 37 days, which is exciting, but it also says a lot about the professionalism of Trump's campaign. But overall, it's good news that new people are being involved in politics. The bad news is that in this campaign in particular, some of the leading candidates for the presidency have made extremist statements on issues ranging from immigration to torture to trade, and these extremist positions have been broadcast at high volume. Now, in the midst of a tumultuous election, it can be difficult to see a country's political fundamentals, and that's mainly what I want to focus on this afternoon, because in a tumultuous campaign, rhetoric dominates the news, extremist positions receive a great deal of attention, a disproportionate amount of attention. The silent majority remains silent, and it's often overshadowed by what would normally be a sideshow. Now, I'll return to the candidates later, and I promise to identify the good guys and the bad guys, as Ambassador Ong suggested. But first, I'd like to provide a broader strategic and political context for thinking about U.S. foreign policy. Now, despite what one might have inferred from the campaign, I believe there is a strong, enduring consensus among the American people and the U.S. foreign policy establishment about the U.S. role in world affairs. Now, there are policy disagreements on specific issues, to be sure, but there's a strong consensus, I believe, on three core principles: global engagement, global policing, and global partners. The majority view in the United States is that the United States should be actively engaged in world affairs, that the United States should not be the world's policeman, and therefore that the United States must work with others to promote American national interests as well as our common international interests. Now let me start with global engagement. Most Americans recognize that the United States is part of and enmeshed in a highly interconnected, interdependent international system, and this is going to continue unless a global catastrophe takes place. Most Americans recognize that the United States is a global power with global interest in security and military affairs, business and economics, as well as international politics and diplomacy. Most Americans understand that protecting and advancing U.S. national interests will require robust, multidimensional, sustained engagement in world affairs for as far as the eye can see. Now, this assessment is supported by public opinion polls that have been conducted over the course of the post-Cold War era. And let me just pass along a few of the highlights. According to a recent survey, 91% of Americans say that strong U.S. leadership in the world is desirable. Only 8% say that the U.S. should not play a leadership role in international affairs. Now, this consensus has endured for more than 40-plus years when these surveys have been conducted. This is an enduring, established consensus in the United States. Now, significantly, there's a strong bipartisan consensus on U.S. engagement. When you look at results from Republicans and Democrats, you find almost identical numbers when it comes to the issue of U.S. engagement in the world. Now, in the midst of the election, with all the posturing that's going on and all the partisan sniping, it's easy to overlook this basic fact. There is a strong, enduring, bipartisan consensus in the U.S. on what the U.S.'s role should be in the world. The past two U.S. presidents, one from each party, have reinforced this message in almost identical language. In 2006, President George W. Bush said, and I quote, "America rejects the false comfort of isolationism." This is from a Republican president. In 2014, Democratic President Barack Obama staked out the same position. In the 21st century, he said, "American isolationism is not an option." So Republicans and Democrats both get it. But that brings me to the second point about global policing. At the same time, Americans also believe that the United States should not be the world's policeman. Again, in a public opinion survey, only 11% of Americans believe that the U.S. should be the world's policeman. The vast majority, 72%, say no. We should not play that role on our own. And this view, I would argue, has been strongly reinforced by the U.S. experiences in Afghanistan, Iraq, and Libya. And I expect this view to continue into the future as well. Now, if the U.S. has global interests, and if it doesn't want to be the world's policeman, it follows logically that the U.S. has to work with other international actors to protect and advance American national interests as well as our common interests. And this, in fact, has been the prevailing pattern in U.S. foreign policy in the post-Cold War era. U.S. engagement with other international actors has been multidimensional. The U.S. works with a wide array of states, allies, friends, neutrals, even adversaries when circumstances call for that. The U.S. also works with a wide array of non-state actors, non-governmental organizations, and civil society. The U.S. works with others formally through treaties, regional organizations, and international organizations, as well as informally through coalitions of the willing. U.S. engagement is both regional and global in scope. This has been going on under Republicans and Democrats alike, and I expect it to continue, in part because this strategic logic is, again, strongly supported by the American public. 63% of Americans believe that the United States should play a shared leadership role in world affairs. 60% of Americans are in favor of strengthening the United Nations, which would help us work with others on international problems. These views have been strong and steady over the past several decades. Now, of course, there are bipartisan policy disagreements in the U.S. on specific policy issues. Let me just quickly touch on a couple. With respect to the United Nations, more Democrats, in fact, most Democrats favor a stronger United Nations. Republicans, not so much. That's more 50-50. On climate change, the vast majority of Democrats see climate change as a major problem. Relatively few Republicans see climate change as a big problem. And of course, there are big differences between Democrats and Republicans on immigration. Democrats favor immigration reform and a path for legal status for illegal immigrants. Republicans favor walls, really big walls. There's one issue, though, I want to focus on in a little bit more detail, and that's the issue of trade and free trade agreements, because that's very relevant to Asia, and it's very relevant to the TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, which I'm going to continue to touch on because it's so important and, of course, so relevant here in Asia and in Singapore in particular. Now, in the presidential campaign, international trade and free trade agreements have been criticized intensely by Bernie Sanders on the Democratic side and Donald Trump on the Republican side. Now, you might think that that's the prevailing view in the U.S. because you have these two very loud voices criticizing trade and free trade agreements. In fact, U.S. public opinion is very different. According to public opinion surveys, Americans, by and large, are supportive of trade and free trade agreements. In three recent surveys, including one that was conducted in February 2016, after the TPP was signed, if you look at these surveys, it's usually somewhere between 58 and 64% of Americans support trade. They see it as a positive for the United States. It's usually around one-third, 33-34% of Americans who oppose trade and free trade agreements. Now, I'm rounding off a bit, but basically, two-thirds of Americans are in favor, one-third is opposed. But the one-third that's opposed is intensely opposed, and that's the difference. It's the silent majority that tends to get overlooked, and it's because of the nature of trade. The benefits of trade are spread across a whole country. A lot of people can benefit from a wider variety of cheaper goods, but the costs of trade, especially in terms of those who lose jobs, the costs of trade are highly concentrated, and those people are highly motivated to oppose trade because they're very angry about it. And I think this basic dynamic is also likely to continue in American politics, and it really comes to the front of the discussion during campaigns because that's when those who are opposed to trade are highly mobilized. So just to set the stage, the context, this is how most Americans see the U.S. role in the world. Now let me turn to President Obama. Overall, President Obama has been very much in sync with the strategic and political preferences of the American public. Number one, he's a committed internationalist. He understands that the world is important to the United States and that the United States is important to the world. He gets it, this basic fact of life. Second, he does not see the U.S. as the world's policeman. From the beginning of his first term, he has wanted to disengage the United States from Afghanistan and Iraq, which he sees as quagmires. His decision to intervene in Libya in 2011, in my view, was an aberration. It's an exception to his general policy to stay away from problems you can't solve. And it's an intervention that he now regrets. He now calls it his worst mistake as president. And this experience has reinforced his determination to stay out of Syria, which he has done. And third, President Obama is committed to multilateralism and working with others in international affairs. He understands that the United States does not have hegemonic power. It can't dictate to others. He understands that few problems in the world can be solved by one country acting on its own. No power, not even the United States, can solve major problems unilaterally. In the 21st century, I think President Obama understands that multilateralism is mandatory. It's not a luxury. It's not a courtesy. It's something you have to do, whether you're big or small in the world. I think that his view of the U.S. role in the world is consistent with the multipolar realities of this part of the 21st century. And I think he's a genuine multilateralist, and we don't have time to get into it now, but I think even more than Bill Clinton and George W. Bush, he genuinely believes in and understands and recognizes the role of multilateralism in world affairs. How has President Obama's foreign policy fared overall now that we're more than 7 years into his 8-year term? Well, of course, the outcomes have been mixed, as they always are. There have been some important failures as well as some major successes. The failures are not entirely President Obama's fault. International problems are difficult, especially if they come to the president. Those are usually the ones that other people can't solve. American power is limited. It's also true that presidents make mistakes, and he has made a couple over the course of his time in office. And so let me just give you a quick report card. Since I'm a professor, I'll give you a report card of President Obama's setbacks and mistakes, and then I'll turn to the successes and accomplishments. I'll start with the bad news so that I can end with the good news. The bad news starts in the Middle East. You know, there's an old saying that no matter how bad things are in the Middle East, they can always get worse. And we've seen that, unfortunately and tragically, over the last few years. One of President Obama's mistakes, of course, is Libya, which he himself acknowledges was a mistake. It was a U.S. and NATO fiasco. The French and the British were really keen to get into Libya. They didn't really have the firepower to do anything, so of course Uncle Sam had to get involved as well. But the U.S. and its allies failed to learn the lessons of Iraq in 2003, where we went in, but we didn't have a plan for keeping things stable afterwards, and the result is now essentially a failed state. Syria, from my view, was a debacle, and President Obama has made a couple of very serious mistakes there, starting with his statements about what's going on in Syria. In 2011, President Obama said that Bashar al-Assad must step aside, but President Obama had no plan for bringing that about. He did not give support to the rebels who wanted to overthrow Assad, and the war continued. In 2012, of course, President Obama said that there would be a red line that should not be crossed if Syria was to use chemical weapons, and that would change everything, President Obama said, if chemical weapons were used. In 2013, chemical weapons were used, the red line was crossed, and President Obama waffled. I think that was his single biggest mistake as president. It was a mistake for Syria, a mistake for the region, a mistake for Obama and the U.S. internationally. Assad's position in Syria solidified, the defection stopped, the rebels were demoralized. The result, we now know a couple of years later, is a failed state. Somewhere between 250,000 and 500,000 people have been killed, 3 million refugees, at least 6 million internally displaced people. It's a humanitarian disaster. It's also been a strategic disaster for the region, and now for Europe as well. It's also affected President Obama's credibility internationally among allies, I know for a fact, and I believe among adversaries. I don't know what's going on in Vladimir Putin's mind, but I've talked to a lot of American allies in Asia, the Middle East, and Europe. So far, every single person I've talked to, literally 100% of the people I have talked to, have said that this has damaged President Obama's credibility. Now, President Obama, in a recent article in Atlantic Magazine, which I strongly recommend if you haven't read it, it's available online, it's called The Obama Doctrine by Jeff Goldberg. In this very long article, President Obama said credibility doesn't matter, and he is disdainful of those who worry about credibility. I think this is a strategic miscalculation. When I talk to American allies and friends, they think American credibility matters. They think this was a mistake. It's affected his reputation. It's diminished his power. And I think it's had some global repercussions. Again, I'm not sure what goes on inside Vladimir Putin's mind, but I know what our allies and friends think. Another mistake for President Obama, in my view, is his handling of ISIS, which first was proclaimed in 2013, and in 2014, to everyone's surprise, swept through Iraq, came very close to Baghdad, and President Obama said that the U.S. goal was to, quote, degrade and ultimately destroy ISIS. The problem with that statement is the word ultimately. Too slow, too ineffective. And we can talk about ISIS more if you want. A lot of people worry about ISIS and its use of social media to spread its message. The real problem with ISIS isn't the mechanism of the message. The problem is that its message has credibility because it holds territory. As long as it holds territory, as it does in Syria and Iraq, it is believable that the caliphate could be established. It's important to destroy ISIS's credibility by destroying its control over territory. Now, of course, President Obama doesn't believe in credibility, but I do. And I think that's why ISIS has continued to thrive and attract foreign fighters and inspire self-radicalized people around the world because of the core credibility of its message. I would like to see American air power and allied manpower combine to deal a massive crushing blow to ISIS. And it's certainly true, President Obama knows, that allied manpower hasn't showed up the way we had hoped. And, you know, the Iraqi government is weak, the Turks have their own agenda, our allies in Saudi Arabia and the Emirates have other priorities, Yemen and Iran. And so it's not entirely Obama's fault that others haven't showed up, but American air power, I believe, could be used more robustly. A final problem area for President Obama has been Russia and Ukraine. The U.S. did not focus on the Russia-Ukraine problem in late 2013. It was focused on Syria. It was focused on the U.S. government shutdown. It was focused on China's declaration of an air defense identification zone in the East China Sea. The European Union was involved in negotiations on an affiliation agreement with Ukraine. And the U.S. basically let the EU handle this, and it didn't work out well. This was an issue of great importance to Vladimir Putin. Ukraine is tremendously important to Russia. It's much, much less important to the EU and the United States, and I think we just didn't appreciate this fundamental asymmetry in Russian calculations. And so when February 2014 and March 2014 rolled around, when the Winter Olympics in Sochi were over, literally within days after the Winter Olympics being over, Putin cranked up in Crimea and then in eastern Ukraine. He conquered and annexed Crimea in March 2014, and there really wasn't much we could do about it. We're not going to go to war over Crimea. No one is except Vladimir Putin, and he's now annexed Crimea. Instead, the U.S. and its allies imposed sanctions on Russia. And that was the right thing to do. That was really the main source of leverage that we had. One of President Obama's mistakes, again, sort of came back to his declaratory policy. Again and again, he kept talking about sanctions. He kept threatening Putin with more sanctions. And I asked my research assistant to take a look at the public record to see how many times President Obama had talked about this. And it turned out that in March and April of 2014, over an eight-month period, President Obama threatened President Putin 17 times with threats and sanctions and other economic penalties. 17 threats in 8 weeks. That's two threats per week. During the same period, Vice President Biden mentioned Russia and Ukraine and sanctions five times. Now, if you know Vice President Biden, he loves to talk. And so my rule of thumb here is that if you're talking three times as much as Joe Biden, you're talking too much. Yeah, anyone who's dealt with little kids knows you just don't threaten them all the time because after a while the threats lose credibility. Obama doesn't care about credibility, but I do. And I don't think that's the way you conduct coercive diplomacy. And it has not been as effective as I think it should be. I think my guidance here would come from President Teddy Roosevelt, who said about 100 years ago, speak softly and carry a big stick. And I would add, use stick as needed. I think that's been a weakness for President Obama. Just to wrap up on this, Russia has not and will not withdraw from Crimea and eastern Ukraine. Russia's already engaged in hybrid attacks against Baltic states. Russia's building up its conventional forces. This is not over. This will be a long-term challenge for Europe and the United States. And to wrap up on President Obama's problems and weaknesses. One is that I think he does not understand the importance of credibility. I think this is his most important strategic miscalculation. The second problem, as I've indicated, with the red line and with the sanctions, he talks too much and says things he shouldn't say. Presidents have to be extremely careful about what they say. And please keep that in mind when you think about the candidates. Presidents need to be extremely careful about what they say. And third, I think President Obama on the use of force sees it too much in black and white terms. I mean, his instinct is to lean back, and it's good to be careful, especially if you're the President of the United States. But there are times when you need to lean in, and you need to know which is which. And I think he's too much on one side of that equation. Now, let me turn to successes, because there have been a lot of them. And overall, I think President Obama's track record is pretty good. And I think that's part of the legacy that he will be leaving for the next president. And let me start with the U.S. economy, which, of course, is a domestic issue and it's an economic issue, but it's important. The strength of the U.S. economy is fundamental to American national power. When President Obama came into office in January 2009, the U.S. economy was in a crisis, in a very deep depression, and it was not clear that we were going to pull out anytime soon. But President Obama, with the Democratic Congress, was able to get things turned around. The economy's moved from recession to growth. It's now growing at about 2.5%. It's not great, but it's solid. Unemployment has been cut in half from 10% to 5%. The U.S. is not on a great path, but it's on a good, solid path. And if you're a big power like the United States, that's a good place to be. I'd be happier with 3%, but I'm happy with 2.5. That is fundamental. If the U.S. economy is moving in the right direction, the U.S. will continue to move in the right direction as a great power, because demographically, the U.S. is still growing at a very good rate. President Obama has also had very good success on the nuclear front. The New START Treaty with Russia, signed in 2010, ratified into effect in 2011. The Iran nuclear deal that the U.S. played a leading role in, signed last year. I believe that it is an important and good accomplishment. I'm supportive of it. President Obama also took the lead on the nuclear security summits. He understands that nuclear terrorism is one of the big threats we all need to worry about, and that nuclear security, therefore, is a top national and international priority. The nuclear summits have been held every 2 years. The last one was just held a couple of weeks ago in Washington. That has been very good at placing this issue high on the international agenda and getting other heads of states and government to think about this very important issue. I mean, when people get together for a summit, they read their briefing books. And so for a lot of leaders who don't think about nuclear issues every day, this really forced them to think about it, and that's a good thing. President Obama has also had good success on terrorism, especially in terms of decimating Al-Qaeda Central and terminating Osama bin Laden. Of course, ISIS is a problem. The problem is not over. But one problem that we worried about a lot 10 years ago is a problem we don't worry about in quite the same way today. Climate change, some good progress there. The 2014 bilateral agreement with China is a good step forward. It laid the groundwork for the Paris conference last December. And if you look at Paris 2015 versus Copenhagen 2009, good progress. And I give President Obama credit for staying focused on that. He also took the initiative in opening things up with Cuba, finally rolling back the economic sanctions that had been a failure for 50 years, and starting to normalize relations with Cuba. It's a good step forward, not just for Cuba, but in terms of U.S. relations with Latin America. It's been a thorn in the side of U.S.-Latin American relations, and that has now eased. And Obama's also made good outreach to Brazil and Argentina, two very big and important countries in our neighborhood. On Europe, I think Obama and Ash Carter understand the Russian problem. They have committed $3 billion to building up infrastructure in the eastern part of Europe so we can rotate military equipment in there and troops at a higher rate. And finally, there's Asia, which I put very much in the success column. The so-called pivot or rebalance to Asia is President Obama's grand strategy in geostrategic terms. He understands that getting out of Afghanistan and getting out of the Middle East to focus on Asia is a strategic priority. The rise of Asia makes that imperative. The rise of China makes it important as well. My view is that the rebalance to Asia was well conceived and it's largely been well implemented. The terminology's been problematic, but the fundamental strategic idea is a good one. Military deployments have increased. Military agreements with allies and friends have gone up. That's all good. The Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement, I wish it had moved a little faster, but it's now in the process of being reviewed for ratification. I hope it goes through. I'm a strong supporter of it. Diplomatic engagement has proceeded at a high level. Now, In Beijing, the rebalance to Asia is seen as an American containment strategy. Beijing has made it very clear that they seek the rebalance as containment. President Obama, though, has been very careful to say, and this is where his declaratory policy has been right, he says, we welcome the peaceful rise of China. President Obama has said it is in America's interest to see China succeed. And you can see I've memorized these quotes because they're quite memorable. I've never heard anything from any Chinese leader comparable to that on the U.S. role in Asia. So the U.S. and China have very different views about what's going on. China thinks it's containment. The U.S. says it's not. Well, there's a tiebreaker, and that is, what's the regional response been? And the votes are in. And it's very clear who's winning this election. From Northeast Asia to Southeast Asia to South Asia, from South Korea, Japan, Philippines, Vietnam, New Zealand, Australia, Singapore, Myanmar, India, and other countries, many countries are taking a big step or two closer to the United States because of balance of power calculations. They understand that China is big, it's growing, it's behaving more aggressively, and therefore being closer to the United States is a smart strategic move. The rebalance has been very much welcomed by allies and friends throughout the region. Now, the implementation of the rebalance has not been perfect. I would like to see the U.S., for example, have a more robust and regular and routine set of freedom of navigation movers, freedom of navigation movements in the South China Sea. From my perspective, the U.S. has been a little bit timid and apologetic about this. I think we should just be sailing ships in all the time, because if we believe in freedom of navigation, we should be doing it all the time. The other big issue that's still out there, of course, is TPP, and we're waiting for ratification. I hope it happens, but it hasn't happened yet. My prediction is that China has not and will not withdraw from the South China Sea. This is not over. This is going to be a continuing challenge that we will have to deal with for many years to come. But overall, President Obama has had many successes. There are certain things about President Obama that I admire greatly. He is thoughtful. He is careful. He is analytical. He looks at costs and benefits and risks very carefully. He is a strategic thinker, and he's an analyst. He has a long-term perspective on issues. He has a wide array of advisors, and he listens to them. He's not afraid of a debate in the cabinet room or the situation room. He's had very strong-willed individuals like Hillary Clinton and Joe Biden and Ash Carter advising him. He's not afraid to have smart people in the room. And above all, he's cool. And I mean that he is cool and calm. People talk about no drama Obama. That's who you want in the Oval Office. You want someone who is thoughtful, smart, careful, listens to other people, and is cool under pressure. Those are all very good attributes to have in a president. And so now let me turn to the campaign and the leading candidates. Please keep that in mind. That's what I'm looking for in a president. So you can probably already tell who I'm not looking for. Now, during the campaign, this is the final part of my remarks, most attention has been focused on the theatrical aspects of the campaign, the vicious personal attacks, the vulgarity of some of the candidates, and the vacuity of some of the candidates. But in my mind, two issues are really surprising about this election. Number one is that some of the policy positions of the candidates are unusually extreme. And these extremist views have lasted a long time. Usually the extremists are weeded out much earlier. In this campaign, they have not. And the second thing that surprises me is that the campaign is still very unsettled, even in April. If you go back 4 years ago, President Obama, of course, was up for re-election, so he was a shoe-in on the Democratic side. But even on the Republican side, by March, April, Mitt Romney had things locked up. It was done by April. We knew who the two candidates were going to be. In this campaign, no one has any idea of what's going to happen on the Republican side, except me, and I'll tell you in a few minutes. But we don't really know who the nominee is going to be. So let me turn to the five candidates who are still in the running. On the two sides, the views of the candidates and some of the leading issues, their signature issues. I'll give you my assessments of their positions and where things are likely to go. And let me start with the Democrats, and I'll start with Hillary Clinton. Far and away the most knowledgeable and most experienced of the finalists when it comes to foreign policy. She's an internationalist and a centrist, to put it in the context of what I was talking about earlier. Now, normally, it would not be remarkable to say that a presidential candidate is an internationalist and a centrist, except you can't say that about all of these candidates. Some of them are not. It's kind of bizarre that I have to mention that she's an internationalist and a centrist. If she's elected, I would expect to see a great deal of continuity in American foreign policy and national security policy. Let me just touch on a couple of issues. Use of force. She's a little less reluctant to use military force than Obama. She advocated very energetically for the intervention in Libya in 2011. On Syria, she's called for safe havens and no-fly zones, which President Obama has not put into place. On Iran, she supports the nuclear deal. President Reagan once said, "You must trust but verify." On Iran, Hillary Clinton says, "We distrust and verify." But she does support the agreement. On Asia, she was one of the key figures in the rebalance. She made many personal trips to the region. And some of you might remember in 2010 in Vietnam, she said, and I quote, "We have a national interest in freedom of navigation, open access to Asia's maritime commons, and respect for international law in the South China Sea." So she staked out a position there. On TPP, she has moved away from her prior enthusiastic vocal support of TPP, and I think purely for electoral reasons. When she stepped down as Secretary of State in 2013, at first she stalled on TPP. She said, "I can't say anything about it until we actually see the agreement." The agreement came out last October, and so she moved into phase two. She waffled. And she said, and I quote, "As of today, I cannot support what I have learned about it," end quote. And again, I've memorized it. It was a brilliant statement because in one short sentence, she gave herself two escape routes. She said, "As of today, I can't support what I have learned about it." And so she left open the door that she could learn more about it tomorrow and then support it. And that's, I think, what she wanted to do. But then along came Bernie Sanders, who would not give up on this issue. He's strongly opposed to TPP. And so I think because of the dynamics of the campaign in February, just 2 months ago, she said, quote, "Once I saw the outcome, I opposed it. We failed to provide the basic safety net that American workers need in order to be able to compete and win in the global economy," end quote. So I think Hillary Clinton wanted to sit on the fence and be ambiguous. Bernie Sanders has pushed her to be more explicit and specific about this. This will make it more difficult for her to flip-flop on this if she's elected. But I believe she understands the importance of the TPP, the strategic importance of the TPP. She was present in the negotiations. She understands how important it is. I think there are three possibilities for her to potentially shift back in support of TPP if she's elected president. First of all, she could ask for clarification of some of the treaty's terms. We can't renegotiate the treaty because that's too complicated, but she could try to get clarification. Second, she could put a lot of emphasis on enforcement, very strict enforcement of the treaty's provisions. She could maybe even put some unilateral enforcement mechanisms in place with respect to currency manipulation. And third, she could try to get more funding from Congress, if it's a Democratic Congress, to support American workers. Education, training, retraining, safety net support. And if she got maybe all of these things, she could then say that she has a package of changes that change the cost-benefit calculations and could allow her to support the TPP. If she's elected, I hope that happens. She's left herself a bit of wiggle room, but Bernie Sanders has made it harder for her. And so let me turn to Bernie Sanders. His agenda is overwhelmingly focused on U.S. domestic and economic issues. It's overwhelmingly focused on billionaires and millionaires who are mentioned in almost every other sentence. He hasn't said much about international issues. On use of force, he is the most restrained of the five finalists. When it comes to the use of force, he's even been described as a pacifist. He voted against the war in Iraq, both in 91 and in 2003. He voted for Afghanistan, but he now calls for U.S. withdrawal from Afghanistan. He says that the use of force should only be a last resort and when America's vital interests are at stake. But he also voted in favor of using force in the Balkans in the 1990s. So he's a bit inconsistent, but he's clearly more at the pacifist end of the spectrum. He's talked about strength through diplomacy, which sounds great. President Obama has also emphasized diplomacy, and my guess is that President Obama is much better at diplomacy than Bernie Sanders. Bernie Sanders does support the Iran nuclear agreement, which I see as a good thing. But his signature issue on international affairs has been trade, multilateral agreements, and the TPP. And he says, and I quote, "We shouldn't renegotiate the Pacific trade proposal. We don't need to tinker with the agreement. We need to defeat it. We should kill it," end quote. So that's pretty specific. You know where Bernie Sanders is on that issue. Let me now turn to the Republicans. And I'll start with John Kasich, who is not only is he the most centrist, he's the only centrist of the three Republicans who are currently running for the presidency with respect to foreign policy and national security issues. He's pretty experienced. He was in Congress. He was on the House Armed Services Committee for 18 years. So he's learned a bit. If you look at his list of advisors, it's a lot of the Republican foreign policy establishment. He's the last of the establishment candidates. His policy pronouncements have been pretty centrist. They tend to be tough sounding because Republicans tend to do that. They've been vague because politicians tend to do that. But by and large, he's a centrist, and he's far and away the best of the three Republicans on foreign policy, in my view. On Iran, he says it's a bad deal, but he hasn't vowed to tear it up. On ISIS, he kind of favors what Obama is doing because it makes sense to combine American air power with allied manpower. He would also put safe havens and no-fly zones into the mix. So on ISIS, he actually sounds a lot like Hillary Clinton. On Russia, he's pretty much the same as President Obama, but he would send defensive weapons to Ukraine. But I think he understands we're not going to war with Russia over Ukraine. On China, John Kasich is a lot like Obama, except that he would have maybe an even more robust military and naval presence in the Asia-Pacific region. So he's maybe a little bit more energetic than Obama, but in the same ballpark. But one of the things I really like about John Kasich is on TPP. Of the five finalists, he is the only one who has publicly endorsed TPP. He said, and I quote, "The TPP, it's critical to us," end quote. I think he gets the strategic and economic arguments for TPP. One final thing I like about John Kasich is that I think he actually understands and has respect for American core values. He talks about tolerance of different worldviews and religious beliefs. He is the only one of the Republican candidates who talks a lot about tolerance, multi-ethnic, multi-religious understanding. And that's a good segue to the two final Republican candidates, starting with Ted Cruz, who's an internationalist but more of a unilateralist. He's very enamored of tough talk, generally in lieu of specifics, but when he provides specifics, they are often outrageous, offensive, unrealistic, and counterproductive, and contrary to American national interests. On the Iran deal, he said he will tear it up on day one. He says the Iran nuclear deal is, quote, "the single biggest national security threat facing America right now," end quote. That's a very powerful statement. It's also wrong. I mean, it's just not the biggest national security threat facing the U.S. On Russia, there's a lot of tough talk, arms to Ukraine, ballistic missile defenses to Poland and the Czech Republic, but not radically different from what we're doing or what John Kasich would do. On China, Ted Cruz has a lot of tough talk, especially on cybersecurity and human rights. On TPP, he wants to renegotiate it, but doesn't say exactly what he's looking for. But there's another cluster of issues that, for me, is especially problematic with respect to Ted Cruz and his candidacy. On ISIS, lots of tough talk. Again and again, he's talked about carpet bombing ISIS, which technically under the Geneva Convention would be a war crime, so not a good thing. On torture, he said, quote, "we would use whatever enhanced interrogation methods we could to keep this country safe," end quote. That's contrary to U.S. and international law. And on treatment of American Muslims, he has said that police should, quote, "patrol and secure Muslim neighborhoods," end quote. That's not realistic. He's a lawyer. He went to Harvard. He should actually know that the president cannot order local police to do that. So it would be illegal, unconstitutional, undemocratic, immoral, and it would weaken American national security. But except for that, it's one of the central pillars of his campaign, and that would be really bad except for the final candidate, Donald Trump, who I have to talk about. because politics requires me to talk about it. Donald Trump has conducted a couple of long interviews with the Washington Post and New York Times editorial staffs in the last few weeks. You should read those interviews. The transcript is on the Washington Post website. It's really when, for the first time, a lot of his views have been laid out in great detail. And I think really it's just in the last month or so that a lot of us have come to appreciate that he's really quite an isolationist, in addition to being a unilateralist. And on economic issues, he's really a mercantilist. He is building a bridge to the 17th century. Let me just touch on a couple of the pronouncements that he has made with respect to American allies in Asia and Europe. Allies need to pay more, or we're going to go home. So with respect to South Korea and Japan, they need to pay much more of the costs, or the U.S. will pull out. Trump doesn't seem to care or see any strategic value in being deployed in Asia or Europe or the Middle East unless we're getting something out of it financially. On nuclear issues, he identified nuclear proliferation as, quote, the biggest problem in the world, end quote. But he doesn't care if South Korea, Japan, and Saudi Arabia acquire nuclear weapons. And when he was pushed on this, he didn't really seem to understand that nuclear proliferation could include proliferation to allies. He seems to think that nuclear proliferation only involves the bad guys. On trade, he says, trade is killing us. That's a quote. He's going to pretty much renegotiate everything. He's threatened to impose a 45% tariff on imports from China. He's also threatened Japan and Mexico with higher imports. He, of course, wants to throw out or renegotiate TPP. The Iran nuclear deal, he wants to renegotiate that because he's a great negotiator. But then things actually get worse because when it comes to talking about ISIS, he pretty much wants to bomb it massively. He has talked about taking out and killing the families of their terrorists, which would be a war crime. He has talked about a total and complete shutdown of U.S. borders to Muslims, which is contrary to American law and tradition and would be highly counterproductive. But the worst of the worst is on terrorism, which he seems to be genuinely enthusiastic about, which it would be contrary to U.S. and international law. And so with Cruz and Trump, I very much want to point to John Kasich and George W. Bush, who I think are Republicans who have had a very different conception of what America should be doing. And I want to read you a quote from George W. Bush. 6 days after 9/11, he said, "The face of terror is not the faith of Islam. That's not what Islam is all about. Islam is peace. These terrorists don't represent peace. They represent evil and war," end quote. So on Trump, just to wrap up with him, like most Americans, I'm astonished and appalled that a person with his character, behavior, and policy positions is still prominent in the U.S. presidential campaign. He's made dozens of offensive and outrageous statements, any one of which should have taken him out of the running, but he's still in the running. A lot of his positions are radical, but not in a well-considered way. As I was going through the transcript and making notes, I would put down words like uninformed, simplistic, vacuous, bombastic, pugnacious, adolescent, inconsistent, impractical, unachievable, contrary to American values, illegal, unconstitutional, immoral, stupid, counterproductive, damaging to U.S. national security, dangerous for American allies in the world, could be the beginning of the end of the U.S. as a great power. I also have questions about his character, temperament, integrity, coherence, judgment, and stability, but I think I'll stop there. I think you understand that I'm not going to be contributing to his campaign. The good news is that although he's been getting 30 to 40% of the vote in the Republican primaries, that's about 15 to 20% of the vote overall. I think it won't go down, but I don't think it'll go up. I think there's a hard ceiling there. And even a lot of Republicans, 40% in a recent survey said, 40% of Republicans are scared of Donald Trump. So let me conclude. And I'm going to conclude by returning to Winston Churchill, who said, quote, "You can always count on Americans to do the right thing after they've tried everything else," end quote. I think that's what's going on in the presidential campaign. We're trying out everything under the sun, from Bernie Sanders on the left to Ted Cruz on the right and Donald Trump, who lives on his own planet. I actually hope he gets one. He can call it Planet Trump, and I would be happy to blast him into space. But in the end, I expect, as Churchill would have predicted, that American voters will elect a sensible responsible person to take the oath of office on January 20th, 2017. And I know you all want me to make predictions, so I'm going to do it. I don't know who's going to win the Republican nomination, but I do know this. The Republican Party is split very badly. I think there are three scenarios: Trump, Cruz, or somebody else. No matter which scenario happens, the Republican Party is going to be badly split. If it's Trump, very large numbers of Republicans and all independents are going to go somewhere else. They'll either vote for the Democratic nominee or they won't vote at all. I believe Trump would lose in a landslide. If it's Cruz or somebody else, Trump supporters are going to be very unhappy. They're going to stay away. If it's Cruz, he's actually very much at the right wing of the Republican Party. Under normal circumstances, he would both be the most extreme person in the room. And if he gets the nomination, I think a lot of moderate Republicans and independents will go for someone else. And if it's someone else altogether who gets the Republican nomination, I think the Republican Party will be in chaos going into the fall campaign. So I think the structure of the situation, I don't know which scenario is going to happen, but the structure of the situation, I believe, is that the Republican Party is going to be very badly split going into the general election. I believe the Democratic Party will unify quite enthusiastically. My prediction is that the Democratic nominee will win in a landslide, and I believe she will do an excellent job as president. Thank you.